Everybody, how's it going? So the good thing is it's about audio, so you don't, like, if you want to look at your food instead of me, that's okay, as long as your ears are tuned in, we should be fine. I love these conferences. This is actually my favorite location of my favorite conference. I've been working with John and Seth for 10 years or so, so coming from different companies, but I still come back, so thank you guys for always having me. I'm going to take you through kind of what I call a sampler platter. It's really hard when you're the only audio content in this kind of format to know what you're looking for and what you guys want to kind of hear. So I'm going to give you just like a case study showcase, show you kind of the bells and whistles that we have. And then based on the conversation that I've been having just throughout the day, I am going to do a little bit of pivots and kind of bring up some things. I will say, I will talk about AI. Are we doing the drinking game with AI yet? I wasn't here yesterday. Is that happening? A stop for every time we say it? Okay, all right, let's get it. So without further ado, raise your hand if you listen to audio. All right, we're going to breeze through these, okay? We're going to go, it's part of our lives. You probably have done like 3 out of 5 of these circles already, so we're good there. It's growing. It's showing no signs of slowing down. Obviously, online listening is growing. Podcast is so hot right now. It's crazy. One of the things I found recently in doing some research for a byline that I wrote is that it's a really young and diverse landscape. So on streaming, 83% of the listeners are 18 to 34. Podcasts, that's 50% are 12 to 34, which is crazy. What 12-year-old's listening to a podcast? I hope it's like a textbook. And it's also very diverse. So we're looking at the LGBTQ community, and 19% of them identify, 19% of Gen Z identify, and 11% of millennials identify. And from the BIPOC perspective, 3 out of 5 Americans have Latin roots. Like, one of them. 68% of Black Americans say that they're a music enthusiast, and 70% of Hispanics are consuming audio, and they're saying this specifically because of the ease of accessibility. So this is really great. Okay, what are we talking about now? So audio, everybody's listening. You guys know the insane power that it has for you. So kind of what we're able to do is take this long-standing medium and its power and then pair it with digital, like programmatic capabilities, right? So these engaged audiences, higher listen-through, better recall, which I'll talk about in a little bit, higher intent to purchase, also going to talk about a little bit. And we're taking programmatic advertising, which everybody here is really an expert on that, enhanced targeting, which we'll look at, brand safety, and really efficient buys, right? We're able to pair all of these. Speaking of that enhanced targeting, just like you guys can know, there's so much you can do with programmatic audio right now. It's insane, and a lot of these case studies I'm going to take you through dive into these capabilities. So before we do that, like, I know you guys are wondering, what's an AdWizz? So we build technology for a sound world. We've been around for over 15 years. We are audio-centric DNA. That's what we do. It's the only product we produce are for audio. And we deliver a lion's share of the ads that you hear. So of those people who raised your hand, if you're listening to an ad-supported platform, I'm really willing to put my money on the fact that we delivered that podcast ad or that radio ad to you. There's just some fun stats. We are very much a global company. Diving a little bit into the technology, we started on the publisher side, so we have an audio-centric SSP and a campaign manager, and this is really taking about 80% of the publishers across the globe who are using our technology. And then we have, for this room here, we have a couple different ways that advertisers can connect to that massive amount of inventory that we're connected to. One's through our audio-centric DSP, we have a self-serve platform, and then we also have a marketplace, which I'll get to a little bit. On the your left-hand side, you can see everything that kind of this is built for. What I will call out is the campaigns and the case studies I'm going to show you have a lot of these cool, innovative formats. These bells and whistles exist within our DSP. And then bring it all together, our beautiful marketplace, the place for all, for publishers and advertisers to come together. And then logo soup. This is who you always got to have a logo soup. These are the publishers and advertisers, or just a sample of them that we work with across the world. This is being a little bit more U.S.-centric. Okay, that's it. That's enough of the spiel part there. I like to dive into the fun stuff. So we're going to do some case studies. dynamic creative optimization is just a really long-winded way of saying creative versioning. So creative versioning has existed and has been desired across the for everything that you want to do, right? Reaching your audiences. What makes it so unique in audio is the lift of the campaign is a lot lower. You're only creating an audio file. And then the dynamic creation of it based on your targeting capabilities is insane what you can do in real time. So we've recently worked with a company called Mustard. I feel like we're just doing really weird company names today, and I'm here for it. I'm excited for it. So Mustard is an auto insurance comparison tool, and what they set out to do was see if they could raise brand awareness, favorability, and website traffic, as well as purchase intent. So what they did is they used CCO. This was actually a campaign that took place in the UK, and the UK targeted 4 key locations. And with those 4 key locations, that geolocation, they were honing in on listeners based on their age and based on their location, which I mentioned. So they were able to dynamically create an ad depending on where the person was pinged in their location. And they would say, like, hey, drivers, you know, 37 years old, how much are you paying for your car insurance based on your location? So they were able to do all these different iterations of this in real time. They brought in Veritonic to determine all the goals that we set out before, and the way that they did that was they gave a respondent 4 ads. 1 was generic, and 3 were based on these location and age targeted ads. And then they were asked to, you know, what was the impact of these ads that you heard, and they segmented those results in the targeted and non-targeted. Spoiler alert, targeted one, big time. So these results were great, especially in the favorability. This is also one, it's a much older case study, but I cannot bring it up. It is so freaking cool. So Corona Beer wanted to expand their brand awareness in New Zealand, and they wanted to do that by sponsoring these custom surf reports. So what they did is they combined live API weather data, and then they were able to target a listener. So there's like, I don't know, I think there was 20 different major surf spots, and based on where you were, if you were like within 15 kilometers of this specific beach, then you would get served this custom surf report. So think about all these different variations. There was like 6,000 different possibilities based on wind, swell, tide. I'm not a surfer. I'm sure there's some other things involved there. And they were able to say, hey, and combine all these things together. I wish I had the audio sample here for you, but it is on the website. So you can hear it's probably about 15 different types of data that was customized, but it sounded completely seamless, like a real person giving you a live surf report. They delivered over 700,000 custom surf reports during the course of the campaign, and again, the goal being Corona Beer not being huge in that market, they increased their relevancy by 2%. Was that the right one? That was on the right one. Okay. Audio pixel second screen targeting. Spoiler alert, it does what it says. It does what it says on the box. So I'm not going to explain specifically what these are. I'm just going to dive into the case study for you guys. So Mazda, a local Mazda auto dealership, wanted to drive awareness. You guys are starting to see some themes here. Purchase decisions, and they really were focusing on drumming up attention and traffic to their sales events. So when I hear sales events, I'm sure all of you hear the same announcer in your head, like, local sales events, come down now. So it was really that, and they were already using programmatic display, and they wanted to fortify that with audio, and their goal was to reach the consumer in several touch points throughout the day with higher frequency. They used second screen retargeting. Maybe the only difference here on maybe how you're used to seeing it is we do an audio first and display second, and the ways you can control what the frequency is or how far out you're going to deliver that display ad after the audio ad was delivered. And then audio pixel is a way of dropping a pixel just on our digital platforms, right? So this is website traffic. You can track an app or coupon download. You can do an ad to cart. There's lots of different ways that you can track this. So, and it did really well. We're not terribly surprised on this. But what we thought was really cool, these are the comparisons of the programmatic display only as compared to the digital. The things that really stood out for them was obviously the insane increase on their website traffic and then the interaction once that person was there. Okay, so this was me this morning going, no, you have to, like, wedge this in here. So when we had talked about audio performing really well, I think in a lot of conversations that we had too, is kind of like this retargeting. We were joking about retargeting in real life. So this campaign was, or the study was done by a partner of ours called Octave Audio. And they were helping promote a peanut butter startup. And the peanut butter startup wanted to obviously use social and then obviously wanted to use audio. So what they decided to do was run the social first and then just have a 1 week overlap with the audio. So the social campaigns went out, a promo code, I lied to you. Audio went first. Promo code was given on the audio campaign. Hey, you know, visit our website, you type in peanut butter or something like that for your discount. And then the social ran next. And if you think about the way in which you listen to audio, like, are you in front of a computer? Probably not. Like, is your phone unlocked? Probably not. The ways in which you listen to audio, it doesn't really make it easy for you to convert. But what this really does is show the power of audio over the other ways of getting that information in. So the social campaign ran, it ended. Audio ran, and then it ended. Then social went with a completely different promo code. Audio promo code, different than the social promo code. What was happening was people were clicking on the social promo code because they could, because it was an easy way for them to convert, but they were inputting the audio promo code. And so that was kind of what they called the audio afterglow. And I can give you the exact details on it, but I think it's just another way of showing how if you pair things and let audio, like, flex its muscles, and then you get a little bit of support from a digital platform, it works really well. Okay. Are we going to take bets on whether or not this is going to play into the sound? If you were here last year, it was pretty funny. Oh, look at, he's over here doing it.
Fear of commitment. It can be hard to overcome. Now you can finally choose not to choose. Introducing Access by BMW, a subscription service that lets you switch vehicles whenever you want, as often as you want. So the only thing you own is the road. Subscribe, drive, switch with Access by BMW. Shake to download the Access by BMW app now.
Awesome. Oh, I need help. There we go. I'm not going to go through these slides yet, but one thing I wanted to kind of segue real quick was measurement. And again, like when you're kind of delivering a sample platter, it's hard to know how deep you want to dive. One thing based on kind of what I shared with you about that social campaign and the challenges that audio may or may not have with measurement has put us in a position to think really creatively. Is that a word? Really creatively. On how you measure, right? So when you have an innovative format like this where the user can shake, you're immediately measuring engagement as well as interaction. And you're having this data in real time, so you're able to optimize on what works and what not. You could even you can take maybe a DCO campaign and combine it with a shake me or interactive one like this to really start getting creative and robust in how you're measuring it. Like I said, I won't go through this case study just for time, but I just will show the results. This was a case study that we did with VW and PhD, and it was really about driving website traffic and getting people to come to, like, a local area. So it was local targeting, and they were able to customize the ads based on which dealership they wanted to send them to. And it was, you know, almost twice what Google Display does within the auto vertical. Okay. I'm going to close it out with podcasts, because podcasts are hot, right? Who doesn't love a good podcast? My son, when I would listen to podcasts in the car, would say, Mom, it's okay, you can turn your learning music back on. Let me go here my notes real quick. It's based on conversations that we're having around the measurement side, around kind of like just hearing things like how you measure audio. It's whatever you want. Like, you can do it in real time. You can get the same digital media metrics that you're used to. You can do brand lift studies. Those are going to take a little bit more time. You can do these interactive formats, which give you engagement, interaction. You can also get dashboards, y'all. Dashboards for audio, real-time optimization. So those exist. Now, moving into podcasts, I would like to thank Emoto for going over predictive audiences and geocontextual. So I'm not going to dive into what those are too much rather than just show you results, because those are also things that exist within the podcast sphere. So again, when you think about podcasts, what makes it so strong? It's the content. And the way in which you listen to it is even can be more slightly challenging than even audio in general. It does have less signals than other types of media. So really leaning into the content and understanding what you can gain from that from a targeting perspective is extremely powerful. As far as how our contextual targeting works, when a podcast gets published and it gets sent to us for information, that comes either through an API connection or an RSS feed. And once that hits us, then we automatically start doing a speech-to-text transcription of the audio file. And then that gets fed into our contextual engine. I didn't come up with that name, but I wish I did. I love it. And today, right now, what's happening is over 5 million episodes, and this is a little bit out of date. This is probably, like, I'd say 6 months out of date. We have over 5 million episodes that are transcribed and actionable for contextual targeting, which I'll dive a little bit more into. 40,000 of those or more are Spanish language, so you're not limited, and you can think about multicultural. It's like over 250 years of content. If we do our math, actually, we're averaging about 100,000 new episodes monthly, and this is about 6 months out of date, times six, you can do the math. What we are seeing is, what you're able to do with this database of words and things is you're able to start searching by topic. So gone are the days of going for a genre or even going for a show. Now you can search by a topic. So for example, if you want to lean into golf, but maybe a golf topic is happening on a political like show. Maybe like Freakonomics is talking about it. Maybe like a kids show is talking about it. So now you can get this topic across multiple episodes and a wider reach of audiences, which you weren't able to do when you were kind of going into that really granular like show or genre. You can include or exclude. This is fantastic. You can optimize campaigns in real time. I had to give this note to myself. That's targeted or not targeted reporting. So we can show you where you delivered on what you targeted. We can also show you what you didn't target. We can show you what opportunities and avails were there based on your targeting criteria that kind of matched your audiences. So you can see maybe what did I miss? What worked, like maybe I missed the bar and like now I'm seeing who was listening and who was tuned in. So it's just the capabilities are really fun. Fun if you're a nerd like me. These are just different segments that we use as well that you can help enhance your audience segments and targeting. Brand safety, suitability, especially in podcasts, that's really, really challenging. And this is another way of kind of getting around that. We talked about getting granular, expanding your reach. One of the things that we did with NPR, which is a longstanding partner of ours, was helping them, and you think about the content that they have, their advertisers have a big concern about things like the Ukraine war, the pandemic, political. This technology helps them give their advertisers peace of mind that they're able to, like, not have to avoid a show completely, but now they can just avoid an episode that maybe has this content in it. We won an award with it, so it's really great. I think the thing that's most important is the people who are listening to podcasts. This is enhancing our listening experience and our ad experience, which is we're selfish, and that's what matters at the end of the day. Predictive audiences, same technology, contextual targeting, contextual engine, AI, but it's taking ComScore's global opt-in panel information as well and layering it on top of that. So now you're able to take media consumption behaviors and top it with this information around contextual targeting for podcasts. On the right here, oh, that was an interesting build. Okay, on the right here, we've been running campaigns heavily since June, and on the right here are just the types of advertisers that have been seeing a lot of success with this. Okay, this is it, you guys. This is the last one. You ready? Okay, podcast. If you listen to a podcast, did you hear a host-read ad or did you hear a dynamically inserted produced ad? Thank you. I will work on my question forming. Both, right? And then do you know if your host-read was dynamically ad inserted? Well, if you don't know, hopefully it was, and you're not wise to it. Host-read is powerful. It is the most powerful. It is native. It has a trust factor. It feels like the content, like, don't mess with it. But can we automate it? Can we make it easier? When you think about for the buyers as well as the sellers, when you think about the host, it's like one dude in a small team. And he's got lots of people coming after him, and they want to do the host read or the sponsorship. That's a lot of manual processes. This not only helps the host and the publisher to kind of automate this process, it also increases demand. Because what was happening before is, like, you only have, like, two hands and 2 feet. You can maybe handle, like, 12 host read or sponsorship deals. By bringing in the automation and technology, they are able to expand their demand, expand their advertising palette. And what we got back to before is it helps us because we're not hearing the same mattress or, like, meditation ad over and over and over again. We have this in a beta program for a while now, and shout out to Harrison, who managed this beta program for us. And one of our advertisers was an online retailer and ran, I think it was 7 different campaigns, maybe using 2 different hosts, and saw an average decrease of 34% in their CPA by using this automated host read ad. It was very cool, and it is out now live, and we're very excited about it. That's it for my slides. The other thing I will say on the AI side is that, I mean, oh, I forgot. Can I start again?
Totally. These people have nothing to do.
I had a dad podcast joke. Are you guys ready? Remember it? Okay. What do you call a monk with a podcast? On air fryer.
It was all in the delivery. Wait for it, and there you go.
There it is. So it's the one thing I will end in the AI frenzy. No, is we do understand AI. We do think that it is something that's important to help. Technology is really made to work for us, and we are doing things around podcast voice ads. And the goal is to really kind of help maybe smaller advertisers who don't have the access or the resources to kind of get out there into the world. But so that's my little AI drop in the bucket.
Drink.
There you go. All right. That's it for me.
All right. Wonderful. Great job.